What's up, Madden 17 fans? My name is Cody, and I want to welcome you to today's video. Today's video, what we're going to talk about is some of the new things that I've been doing from the bunch week, and we're just going to play a game, let you kind of see how my thought process works in a competitive game, and I think that it's really going to help you guys, again, just see what it really looks like and what kind of goes through my head. So this video is going to be less about extra stuff and more about just specifically tactics. And I think that sometimes when I do these commentaries, one of the dangers for me is I want to continually give you guys advice instead of just break down and document exactly what I'm doing. So that's purely what I'm going to do in this video, and I want to see what you guys think of it. So let me know if you liked this version better than previous versions where I get more philosophical. So let me know exactly what you guys think about this video in the comment section. And also, before this guy resumes the online game here, one thing that I want to encourage you guys with is to comment. If you don't comment, if you don't ask questions, if you don't engage, then you might as well just go find another YouTube channel, because my channel is not going to help you, okay? Because in my opinion, I believe that the only way you really get better is by asking better questions, okay? And the better questions you ask, the better answers you're going to get. So I've always believed that, and I just think it's so essential for you guys to ask good, solid questions. I think it's really going to help you guys. So right there, I'm running a different little deal out of the bunch, so I want to just get right into it. So I'm not going to break down the play. I'm going to break down what I'm seeing from him, okay? So he's in Tampa 2. There's no blitz threat, as you can see, because of the linebackers. So where I'm going to look to attack is just run my offense. My reads, I'm going to look to square first. If he's not open, then I can look real quick up there to Kendall Wright on that corner route. Tampa 2, the way it normally works is they're going to do one of several things. They're going to run either a hard flat, a cloud flat, or a soft squat. Those are the three types of zones that you're going to be able to run when you're in a traditional cover two type of set. What most cover twos, where they're weak, is over the middle of the field, especially the short middle, the quick ins, quick outs. That's where you want to attack cover two, because you want to make it kind of like a gnat in their head. There he switched out. He went to a cover three. We were able to hit Chris Ivory on the right there coming through. So there he's kind of starting to change, as you can see. And when people start to change their plays, that's when you know you've really kind of got them out of their comfort zone. That's when you know they're kind of second guessing what they're doing, in my opinion at least. So once he starts to go to different schemes and different things, that's when we can really get him. So it looks like here he's going to go back to cover two. He's bringing that guy on that safety on the right, comes down. That means to me probably some type of cover three. As you can see there, he jumps the wheel route. So he audibled into cover three out of that. Again, that's why you always want to be identifying where those safeties are on every play. So here it comes out, looks exactly like cover two again from the snap. We need to watch the safeties. There he's audibled. As you can see, when the safeties move their feet, that means that he has done some form of audible. So he's probably in cover two man or cover three. He's in cover three. I know I have that quick little release route on that delayed slant. Some of you guys might have watched Skimbo run something similar to this in the Madden Challenge. This is very similar to what Skimbo is running, and a lot of it's just because I'm just trying some new things out of the bunch, and I figured I would try out this delayed slant that Skimbo was running. Okay. So here, he's got a potential blitz off that right edge. So I need to be careful on that side. So I need to make sure that that's my first look. Right edge, nope, he's down. That means I've got this deep route to DeAndre Hopkins over the top. Once I saw that he wasn't blitzing, then I knew immediately that I had time to be able to hit somebody else. Okay, so that's kind of what I was thinking there. First and 10 from the 12-yard line. This is a weird spot. Position on the field, you have actually a lot of room to do a lot of different things. The only problem is what most people try to do is they try to score from the 12-yard line instead of just try to advance. What this guy's going to do is he's probably going to blitz me off the right edge here. Yep. Oh, he ran commit. Oh, wow. Great play call. That was really good. I don't know what I was thinking there. Man, that was a good play call by him. So he ran commit. I have never seen someone do that. On like the 12-yard line. I really haven't. That's something I've never seen before. So good play by him. He got me. I had a wide open touchdown. I just completely thought he was blitzing off the. I thought he was sending the corner off the edge, not run committing. So that was a really, really good play call to him. So good play by him there. But that's one thing about that though, is that means he's getting very, very complacent. So all right, so starting out, he's gonna run bench from snugs. What I like to do at the beginning of the game is I like to sit in Tampa 2 from 4-3 under. We have talked about that several times. There's a reason why. The bottom line core philosophy is I want you to have to go short. Okay? So if you run a quick little in route, I don't care. What I don't want to have happen is I don't want you to be able to throw deep post routes against me. Okay? That's just something that I really don't want to have happen to me. So there he runs inside zone. I'm okay with that too. Like if you just want to run inside zone for a little bit, I'm okay with that. Because I want you, what I think we don't quite understand in the Madden community is this idea of psychology. Like even though it seems like it's a virtual game and I'm playing the computer, like I'm playing a real person on the other end of this. Like, and so you've got to get into the psychology of it, I think, a little bit if you're going to be successful. Because what the psychology is going to do is it's going to get you to realize now we're playing chess, not checkers. And so you've got to start thinking, if I was the guy on the other side, what would I do? When you start thinking like that, in my opinion, it changes how you call the game. It changes how you decide what plays you're going to run. Okay? So like most people, fourth and inches, he's probably going to run quarterback sneak, okay? That's probably what he's gonna do. Now I know that if I just sit here, I have a shot at stopping quarterback sneak and halfback power out. No run commit, nothing complicated there. I just ran the 60 double blitz. That's all I did. I grabbed the middle linebacker and set over the center to make him think that he couldn't run quarterback sneak. He runs halfback power out, and there is the chess match that I'm talking about. All right, offensively, we get a chance at redemption here, even though we really screwed up on the previous play. Dang it. That route is a little finicky. I'm still kind of working on it. I like the fact that you can just pop it out quick. One thing that's interesting to note is the volume at which he's been running cover three. So In the beginning, he was running a lot of cover two. Now you're seeing his corners are back. He's running more of what's a cover six. So what he wants to do is he's going to run cover six, which is cover three on the right side. Or excuse me, it's cover four on the right side, and then on the left side he's going to run cover two. So I know that to my left that means that Gabriel should be wide open on this corner out deep. If I possession catch it, back shoulder, nice. So that's just something that kind of comes with time. That's my counter as well, though. That's the counter to the power, because my power is the spot where Gabriel's going to come out and then he's going to come back in. Now, the reason that it works is because the counter, which is the stick route, which is just a very simple little route that he's going to cut to the outside. The reason it works is because of what we've been establishing previously. Right there, we went to wide receiver curl. The reason we went to that is because the X receiver runs kind of a speed in route. And I believe that it's very effective if you throw a high pass lead, because they're so busy thinking about the motioned out slant and some of the other things that you've been doing from the formation, they don't really think about the route to the slant route. Another play that you could run there is also the clear out SE option, which is a play that has the tight end on a post route. Again, we've talked a lot about that. That is high pass leading post routes inside the red zone is very effective. No matter which receiver you go to, high pass leading those routes is, again, it's very effective. It's something that I truly believe in. All right, so here he's probably going to run bench, but he hasn't had a whole lot of success, so he might go to something else here. maybe a halfback dive. Yep. So there he runs the ball. So again, he's kind of in a no man's land. Even though he's really not in a bad position psychologically, he's kind of lost right now. He doesn't know what he's doing. We're getting some good heat from our base rush. I like running Tampa 2 from 4-3 under. Some people will ask why. Honestly, I just am a big fan of the 4-3 under. I've done a lot of research on it. I think it from a tactical real football perspective. However, I have found that in this game, it actually works really well because of the positioning of the linemen. If you spread them, you get a little bit of a better rush. So there he changes out of his formation, goes to and this is what I was talking about. So right there in that position and down, I mean, everybody knows what he's running when he goes to that formation. He's going to run PA wide receiver in. Okay, that's exactly what anyone would run in that situation. He needs a big play, he's going to run that play. And so there I'm just able to like know it and know where to go and know kind of what he's doing, and there you see it. So I just think that right there was a bad thing on his part. That's why I suggest not going to multiple formations, like staying in one set, because you can do it creates tendencies and different psychological things. In my opinion, it's just it's the best way to do it, because they don't know. They don't know what you're going to run, and you don't even. I mean, you have so many things at your disposal when you really get deep with a formation. There he goes to the hard flat. The reason I knew he was in a hard flat is because he pressed my receiver. So again, I've ran the same play pretty much the whole game. Okay? I think I've changed like twice. But my changes are really, really powerful and are really at powerful times. So it makes them mean something. And that's what I kind of want to get at. Like, again, it doesn't mean anything if you just call a bunch of random plays. Because the essence of the play, when you really break it down, you're either breaking inside or outside. You're either going deep or short. Like, those little things, that's all you're really doing. It's very, very subtle tweaks. Most people try to make big changes. I recommend little, subtle tweaks. There he ran commit again. I was ready that time. DeAndre Hopkins dropped a touchdown. I don't know how or why that happened, but he did. That's so frustrating. I wish I had verticals in this, in my quick audibles, but I don't. So again, real quick, be thinking. One other thing that's really important to understand is you don't want to turn the ball over when you're in scoring position. Most people make that mistake. They try so hard to get a touchdown that they're willing to turn the ball over. You've got to realize that points are at a premium, especially if you're playing somebody good. So because of that, you want to throw high percentage routes. I don't like to go for it on fourth down in situations like this where I can make it a two possession game. Okay, so we're talking about possessions, not about points. And I think that's important for some people to realize. Think about that. You need to think about your possessions, because if I have 14 points on the board, it looks better, but 10 points really does pretty much the same thing. It's two possessions, okay? So obviously there I would have loved to score a touchdown. If DeAndre Hopkins wouldn't have dropped it twice, it would have been, you know, I would have probably got it in for 7, but I'm not going to go for it on fourth down and risk, even though it's a very easy conversion. I don't want to risk losing a possession, okay? Because if I miss that possession, because I threw an interception in the red zone earlier on in the game, and you saw, like, I mean, if I would have scored there, it's 17-0, okay? So, again, just think about that. Here, this is kind of a 5-wide. You got to think wide receiver screen these days. 5-wide is actually, in my opinion, I think 5-wide is actually one of the better passing formations in the game. But what people do is they end up doing what everybody does. They run the popular plays. Like, they run wide receiver screen, verticals, and inside wheels. And that's what they run. There's PA wide receiver in again. See, again, this is what I'm saying. Like, I can't really do a whole lot right now. That's why I'm just kind of hanging in cover two. Intercept that. Come on. So there he went to four verts. See, a reason I moved my linebacker there was to kind of like let him know that I see what he's doing. Let's see. He goes to goal line here. So we'll go to cover four. Power O. Nice run. Nice run right there. That was good. Frank Gore. Here it's all about kind of limiting him to three. Right now we're kind of in that phase of the drive. So I'll do a couple of things. How has he got here is really important too. Like, what are the plays that he's really ran that really has got him to this position? And to me, he's ran power O one. I think he ran a drag. There's a bench. Oh, we had him. Nice. So he ran power. I'm trying to think, how did he get there? He ran power O and he ran a wide receiver screen. So two really subtle little bitty things. So in this situation, third and nine. We're going to try to force him to run with his quarterback because we're going to drop everybody back in coverage. We're only blitzing one guy. If he throws it, yeah. So right there, here's why we did that. He's got the ball on the 39-yard line, okay? If he runs forward with his quarterback, it's going to guarantee him. It's giving him a field goal, right? Because he can get the yardage. He can get about 5, 10 yards, and then we'll tackle him and get a field goal. What I didn't want to have happen was him throw a post route or something for 30 yards, and now all of a sudden he's in a position where he could probably score. So I kind of want to give him the field goal, but now here's one other thing to consider is I now have 22 seconds and three timeouts, and I have a chance now to match him. If I tried to blitz or tried to kind of do more than I did, I think it would open myself up for him to make a big play, and then all of a sudden the half would be over. So you're not just playing the game, you're playing against the clock too. So I think that's something that you also have to be aware of. And again, you just have to kind of fill it out, kind of learn different types of techniques and strategies as the game goes on. But, you know, I definitely think that it's really, really important to at least pay attention to the clock. And again, think about what's going to happen. The psychology, the whole game, the bigger picture is so important. Why are we running Z spot still? Because number one, he hadn't stopped it. But number two, we really haven't. He hasn't really made any attempt to stop it either. And I think that's a big deal. So once he starts adjusting to Z spot, once he starts moving guys and starts to run different coverages and starts doing stuff like that, we will get out of it. Okay, but right now he's making all of the wrong adjustments. He's going to Tampa 2. He's trying to in cross man, do things like that. And in my opinion, this is there's just no reason to get out of it, right? Until he really locks me up. And then we'll start to play the chess match. But until he starts to really lock me up, got a little lag here. Can't really move. Dang it, that's so dumb. I don't know what in the world. That was so frustrating because the stupid lag. So there we have 10 seconds. That's not the play I wanted to call, by the way. I got lagged into it. Man, this field goal is going to be freaking. I like can't even move the flipping cursor. We're not going to kick it. Yeah, we don't want to kick this field goal. Unless it kind of. Thank goodness. So right there, that's, I don't know what, that's part of playing, I guess that's part of playing online with lag. So there's a couple of things that you have to be aware of. Number one, you don't have to kick the ball right away when you have a timeout because you've got time. You've got the whole play clock. So I think that's important. You've got to be patient. Patient is so important. Like smooth is slow and slow is fast. Like it's so true. Take your time. And if it doesn't, and again, there I checked the yardage. I checked where we were from, how far of a distance we had to go while the connection was screwing up. And I realized, like, I could take a timeout or I could take a delay a game or something and I'll be okay. So if the connection doesn't fix up, then I know I'm still okay. I can still do something, okay? So I think that was a smart move because that way I just kind of waited. And I, like I said, I was not going to kick it until the connection smoothed out a little bit. And it ultimately did. We kicked the field goal, and now we're up two scores instead of, you know, getting in a hurry, then getting pissed off because there's lag, and then kicking the field goal and not making it, and just missing it by a mile. He's in a position where I think psychologically, I think he really doesn't know. Nice read. I don't know where my guy was. It's supposed to be oh, he wasn't. I didn't send him. He's been predominantly benched to the wide side. He's going to run here inside zone. When he motions the tight end, he's ran every time. So that's, again, and I've been in Tampa, too, pretty much the whole game. Why have I been in Tampa, too? Because there's been no real reason to take away the crossing routes yet. We haven't been in a position where I need to. So I'm just going to take my time. So he goes to the out route. When he throws an out route on bench, he's going to go to the wide side of the field. So that's always some, those tendencies are important to look at. And that's why, in my opinion, you have to be looking at, you just have to be paying attention. Like, when does he run inside zone? Why does he run inside zone? Why would he not run the same play twice in a row? Like, most people don't do that. Most people want to constantly try to reinvent the wheel. Oh, I was trying to go to that crossing route and I got caught up. So now he's in a fourth and one. So right there, and that right there was probably a situation where I should have called Mike Wilcross, but I just didn't. So there's a smart decision, I think, taking that field goal because of the matchup and like where we're at in the game, limiting it to one possession. Again, so important about the possessions. I really think that's a key factor. If I can be up two possessions, I feel very comfortable with my defense and just kind of where my offense is at as a whole. So here, when you're kick returning, you want to fall down. I have fumbled way too many times. So you do that by holding left trigger, right trigger, and square, and you can fall down. So offensively here, we're going to go to this play right here, this little constraint theory play. If he's in Tampa too, yep, there we go. Oh, dang it. Why can't he? It's so frustrating. Could have easily caught that ball. He thinks we're going to run the Z spot. So you get into this chess match and you start kind of going through. There we go. Another play that we got that's really powerful. I don't know if we have it in this playbook. We don't. Dang it, that's unfortunate. I was looking for the play. Curl flat corner would be a good call right now. But he hasn't. He hasn't really stopped me. Has he? I mean, the interception, the mental mistake, that was a good play call. Because I had never in my wildest, I mean, I never even expected that. There, we just kind of completely screwed up there. He did some weird cross man. I need a C route. Good thing I have it. PA post. Old faithful. Because what he's doing is he's cross manning C. There he is, wide open. Waited a little bit too long to throw. That's again, man. That's the constraint theory. That's the counter power. That's the power counter. Power counter. I mean, he was starting to kind of do some things to adjust. Now I got some options. Again, I haven't even ran the ball yet. Running is something you really do want to do more than I do. I think I do a very poor job in calculating my running plays. So here we're going to run the PA post. When I run PA post from this, I still motion out. I just put him on an in route and motion him a little shorter. Boom, there it is. So, I mean, we're just throwing all over the yard right now. And then, let's see. We're going to run this bunch trail. I like the skinny post on the right. Because he's going to be thinking we're running the route to X. Because that's what we ran last time. So, now we're going to do something different. Man, that was a good... Dang it. It's frustrating. He was wide open. So now we're going to go to wide receiver curl. We're just going to, a couple options we have here. I'm trying to think here what we can do. But I think this will probably be the best bet. Ah, I had him wide open, but one thing that's also important to note is whenever you're running your red zone stuff and you have a route like the wide receiver curl route or a post route to the tight end or whatever it is that you're going to run, it's important to realize and recognize, number one, running the ball is the ultimate equalizer because what it does. Now, here's an interesting situation for you guys. Real quick, before we talk about that, I'll come back to that while we're kicking. Interesting situation. So you got the ball at the 1 yard line. What I like to do in this situation is I like to go to some type of really tight formation. We'll see if I have it. Dang it, we don't have our bearings. We'll take a timeout here. What I like to do in this situation, so ball on the 1 yard line. Everybody and their mom thinks I'm going to go for this, right? A couple things you can do, a couple options you have. He definitely believes you're going to run quarterback sneak or power O or something like that. I really like tosses because normally what the defense will do is they'll over pursue, and this is kind of my counter punch. I mean, this is kind of something that I think you can really do, especially if you only have one shot. So here we've got him. So he's kind of got a pretty good balance here. So then we've got a bunch of options we can do. So if I believe I can get this run in, so you got to count. So my tight end can block, my receiver can block, my thing can go. He's going to try to do it. He's going to think I'm going to take a delay of game. Next thing you know, I pitch it. So what you've got to figure out is you've got to know your plays very well. I know that quick pitch very well because I created a whole entire scheme around the bunch ace, I think, last season. So I know it very well. This season, I think that quick pitch is a very good running play on the goal line. Especially if you have the numbers advantage, because it's very hard to use or shoot gaps this year from a running perspective. So what I'll do is I'll come out and I'll count. If I have a 3-on-3 matchup in a pitch situation where I'm going to pull a guard anyway, normally I will run, I will go for it. Only if that happened, though. So in a situation where he came out in like a dollar 326 or something like that, where he had corner support out there, I wouldn't have went. I would have kicked a field goal. I would have taken a delay a game. So that's one of those situations. Again, you know, if you don't want to risk it, which I believe most of us probably shouldn't risk it if we don't know what we're, you know, if we don't know our plays that well, if we can't really guarantee that we're going to get it, which nothing's a guarantee. But if you can't really guarantee that you're going to get the first down, in my opinion, that's when it's time to, you know, just kick the field goal. So this guy's going to probably go ahead and quit out. He went to again, another popular play, PA post. Looks like he's going to stay in. I mean, he's got timeouts. He's still got a pretty good shot at this game. One thing is very important, though. 20-6, okay? Here's a completely new defense. Haven't seen it yet. He's probably trying to make an adjustment to stop what I'm running on as far as Z spot goes. So he's probably going to be some form of cross man or something like that. So I think that I'll be able to hit that route right there. There it is. So again, that's just kind of checkers. Like, you're playing chess, man. Like, what is he probably going to do? And you're guessing. I mean, you are guessing. Like, if he called Tampa 2 there, I mean, I have my my check down reads and things like that, but I wouldn't have been able to hit the C route, which is why you also want to have exit strategies on every play, and all of that stuff's important. That was a bad read. That's a bad read right there. I don't know what he did. That was really interesting defense he called. Really good play call by him. If I had to play corner strike, this would be really a solid package. So he's kind of sitting on Z spot a lot, and that's when you don't run Z spot. That's when you use plays like PA post to really start to play chess with him. Okay, so if I go, this is a big down here. 3rd and 4 is a big deal right here. What we're about to do. We're not going to run Z spot, even though I probably should. What I'm going to do is I'm going to run the ball. And I'm going to try to take a field goal if I don't get it, okay? I got it. There we go. Nice. So why would you run the ball there? A couple reasons why. Obviously, you want to keep the clock moving. That's obvious. You don't need me to tell you that. But number two, he's not expecting it. I've ran like twice the whole game, okay? Number three, I'm trying to set up for a field goal, because it would put me up 3 scores. I don't really care about a touchdown right now. I care about the clock and taking away time. There he goes to the run commit. We're ready this time, and our receiver catches it, and that's going to put the game away. So, again, still down by 3 scores. You know, so what it is, what it is. Looks like he's going to go ahead and concede. But I hope this video was helpful. I tried to get very tactical, very strategic, very honest with you guys. So I really hope that this did some good. Let me know if it did or not, and what other types of videos